Hello, my name is Ron LaPedis. I'm a co-presenter on this session with Michael Angelo, who I'm afraid cannot join us today, so I'm going to do this session alone. The session title is Bring Your Own Computer to Work, What Now? So we're talking about the consumerization of IT, BYOC, Bring Your Own Computer to Work. We'll talk about how it happens, the organizational benefits and impact of the consumerization of IT, and we'll give you some actions that you can perform today and in the near future and in the far future. So bring your own computer is the consumerization of IT. And what does that really mean? Well, what happened in the early days of computing is that people would decide that they really didn't like the mouse that their company provided to them. And so they would bring in their own mouse, perhaps something that was a little bit more ergonomic. From there, it went on to bringing in your own keyboard. When liquid crystal displays came into vogue, people would bring in their own LCD monitor to replace that huge CRT or cathode ray tube monitor. Companies today allow people to dial in from home, and so rather than carrying a desktop or laptop home, you might use your own machine that you already have in your den or your home office and use that for remote access. You probably have a mobile phone that you also use for business calls. Smaller devices might be USB flash drives, personal digital assistants, such as the Palm Pilot, which came into business very early, a music player, a smartphone. Today we'll be talking about desktops and laptops, but you might also have your own personal Wi-Fi card that you connect to your desktop or laptop computer and use that as well. But we're really not going to discuss that directly. In other words, consumerization is the use of employee-owned resources for doing company work. Now, how widespread is this? According to Instat, fully 40% of computers used in business today were purchased by the employee. Now, that is not to say that that is the employee's only computer. It just means that it's a computer that the employee does use for business, and in fact, might be their home machine, which is used for remote access into the employee's network, or perhaps to edit some documents at home and bring them into the office the next day. However, according to Instat, 10% of laptops are the primary laptop used by an employee in the business, and they purchased it themselves. So this is a personal machine being used for corporate business as the only device that that employee is using. So how does this actually happen? How does consumerization happen? Well, a lot of times now, your 20-somethings walk into the office, and these are 20-somethings that have been doing gaming at home, or they've got a really cool zippity-doo-dah micro-portable laptop that they take with them, or so on, and they don't want to use your Pentium 3. They don't want to use that machine that's underpowered, doesn't have enough memory, they hate that operating system that you're using, whatever it might be. They don't want to use IE6, they'd rather use something like Mozilla, or Safari, or Opera, or Chrome, or something else that's more whiz-bang. They don't want to use your software tools. So maybe you're using FrontPage and they want to use Dreamweaver. Or maybe they don't like your development tools and they don't want to be locked down. And we know that many corporations lock down their corporate PCs so that no additional software can be installed and no customization of the PC can be done by the user. And that just really frustrates people who are used to having complete control over their computing environment. Now, what is your policy? Is it secretive? Do people kind of sneak in their own devices to use in your company and they hide them? Or do they show their devices and the company just kind of ignores it? Yeah, we know so-and-so down in accounting is using their own machine. It's okay, we don't think it's a real big deal. Is it unofficially supported? That means there are no policies and procedures, but you allow the person to bring in their own personal devices. And perhaps if they need to call the help desk, you will actually let the help desk give them some service. Is it officially supported? That is, you allow people by policy to bring in their own equipment. The help desk supports that equipment. Your IT department supports the equipment and you allow them on the corporate network. Or do you even subsidize the use of your own machines? Employee machines. In fact, today there are a number of companies that have decided that if the employee wants to bring in their own machine, they will actually pay for a portion or all of that machine, and pay for support of that machine. So there are some companies like, for example, Citrix, which does subsidize the use of an employee-owned machine in the business. Now, there are benefits and impacts when this happens. Benefits. Companies save between 9 and 40% on equipment purchase cost. Now, this is according to Gartner. What this means is that you get to exit the hardware business. So instead of having to buy a computer every year or every 3 years on an upgrade cycle, when a new operating system comes out or new hardware comes out or the hardware just doesn't have a useful lifetime anymore, you don't need to do that. You get to get off the carousel. You don't need to be on the carousel of hardware upgrades any longer. You let your employees worry about that. It is certainly employee satisfaction. Your employees are much happier using their own machines that they're comfortable with. They use the same operating system at work that they use at home. They have the same shortcuts. They have the same personalization at work that they have at home. They're just much, much more productive. You might find your employees also working longer hours because if they have their own laptop that they carry home with them and they use for home for their home business as well, or for their home activities as well, they might think, oh, there's something I actually need to do for work, and my laptop's sitting here anyway, I might as well just log on and get it done. So you're going to find that your employees work longer. Now, what are some of the drawbacks? Your help desk needs to have knowledge of every single operating environment that your employees might want to bring in. Now, we can kind of assume that your employees are going to settle on Windows, Macintosh, or Linux. There's a few little niche operating systems, but for the most part, we really don't think that employees are going to be using those. So your help desk does need to learn the three major operating systems that your employees might want to use. The help desk may also need to have loaners available. So if an employee-owned laptop breaks for some reason and they need to take it in for repair, they would be completely out of commission without getting a loaner from the help desk. And so you may want to ensure that the help desk does have a couple different machines of each persuasion. They don't need to be exactly personalized for the user, but they should have at least the same operating system and whatever your standard corporate tools are. Now, what about hardware? What about the capability of the hardware? So let's say as an employee, I really like netbooks. And so I buy a netbook and I try to use a netbook as my corporate machine. Well, what happens if that netbook is not compatible with the tools you need to use, the security that you force upon your employees to ensure that there's no loss of corporate information, or what if the configuration of the machine just doesn't match a corporate configuration? What about maintenance and warranty? Who pays for maintenance and warranty? If it's a subsidized machine, your company might pay for that. But if it's kind of snuck in and it breaks, what is the employee going to do? How is the employee going to get that repaired? And what about upgrades? So when new software releases come out, if your company has decided that they're going to upgrade the corporate machines, do they also upgrade employee-owned machines, or is that up to the employee themselves? Now, in terms of software, what about interoperability? So let's say that I want to use a Macintosh with Chrome. What's going to happen if my corporate standard is a Windows PC with IE and Outlook? What if the machine is just completely incompatible with other machines that the company is running? What about upgrades and updates to the software? And what about software vulnerabilities? What if I don't patch my machine? And because I didn't patch my machine, somehow I get a virus and that comes into the business. What now? Those are some of the drawbacks that your company needs to be thinking about. Break. So let's talk about ownership, because ownership is important as well. What if the software that I have on my personal machine is a restricted use license? So let's say I've got Microsoft Office for home and students. The license says I'm not allowed to use that for business. And if I can't use that for business, and I do use it for business, what's going to happen if your company is audited? What about corporate software on home equipment? So let's say I have my personal machine. Your company has a site license, and I use the site license to install that software on my personal machine. Is there an issue with that? What does the corporate license really say? Now, what about personal logon information on corporate machines? So this is kind of the other side. So rather than using a home machine, I'm using the business machine that's supplied to me by my company, but I'm putting all my personal logon information on there so that I can get to my Twitter account, my LinkedIn account, my MySpace account, and so on. So what if I've moved my social networks and professional associations onto my corporate machine? That's kind of the flip side of consumerization. Now, what about corporate logon information that goes to my personal machine? So on my personal machine, I have the configuration for the virtual private network. I've got user IDs and passwords to the corporate network and corporate applications that I've stored in my browser. And what happens? What about privacy also? What about customer data? So in the European Union, you have the Data Protection Act, the EU Protection Act. In the United States, you've got HIPAA, you've got Sarbanes-Oxley, and you've got Gramm-Leach-Biley. What about county, country, state, and local bills like the California Senate Bill 1386 on data breaches? There's plenty of laws coming down. And what happens if information is on a personal machine and somehow it gets out? What is your liability? There's also the issue of cross-contamination for backups. So if I'm running a backup, maybe a one-touch, push a button, and my machine gets backed up at home, I'm now backing up corporate information. If the company is backing up my machine, they've got copies of my personal information. So I've got cross-contamination going on here. I mentioned briefly information leakage. What happens if my niece comes over and wants to use my computer to get onto the internet to play some games? Well, what happens if I got corporate data on there and somehow on the fly my machine is infected because of something that my niece has done? So family and friends can gain access to my data if I let them borrow my machine. What happens if I lose my device, either a smartphone, a personal digital assistant, or again, my laptop? What happens if I leave it somewhere? What happens if I'm infected by a virus because I just couldn't be bothered to either buy antivirus software, or I felt the operating system that I was using was so secure I didn't need it? What about personal email? So my personal email is now running on the same laptop where I have corporate information. And what happens if somebody comes after me because they know that I'm working for a large company and they send me an email bomb to my personal email and I open it? My personal email is not protected by the same protection that I get on my corporate email, where I'm probably running through antivirus and anti-malware servers. My personal email is not. There's also increased exposure to threats. Surfing at home is not the same as surfing at work. At work, I've got firewalls and detections and this and that and the other that I frankly just don't have at home. And what happens if I'm hosting a torrent on my machine? It might be perfectly legal. I might be sharing perfectly legal software that is meant to be shared. But if I'm running a BitTorrent client on my machine, there is a possibility that corporate data could get out. There are other some non-obvious issues. Acceptable use policies. How do you apply those to personal machines? On a corporate machine, you can make it a policy that you are not allowed to surf the internet and play games, or you're not allowed to go to adult sites. But how do you force your employees to do that on a personal machine? Not either go to adult sites or not play games on a personal machine. What happens when an employee leaves? How do you know that your company data is removed from the employee's machine? That includes software, personal files that hold email, passwords, wireless passwords, VPN access. And what about all that residual data now in the employee backups on their push button hard drive backup or on your corporate backups? Again, the mingling of data. So let's just give you some quick action items. Is it already there? Is there already consumerization happening in your company? If so, run, don't walk, to your legal staff. You need to figure out if you are covered, and if you're not covered, what you need to do about it. Decide if you want to allow consumerization. Don't just wait for it to happen and then formulate policy after the barn door has already been opened. You need to ensure that you have policies and procedures before it happens. Whatever decision you make, it must explicitly include all possible components. The decision also must be extended as new technology becomes available, and new technology happens all the time. It's a balance between corporate needs, employee needs, and customer needs. You must comply with all laws, and you must not expose corporate assets. Now, even with policies and procedures, accidents can happen. So you need to ensure that you have an incident response plan to recover from any breach that might have happened due to the consumerization of your IT. let me give you a couple very, very easy technical solutions. These are solutions that you can implement today almost without spending any additional money. So if you do have employees that are bringing their laptops in, you can encourage them to follow these rules. Security 101. Keep secret stuff separate from non-secret stuff. The corollary is you keep corporate stuff separate from personal stuff. That means you want to compartmentalize personal data versus corporate data. The easiest way to do this is through application isolation, separate user accounts, virtual desktop infrastructure such as Citrix GoToMyPC or perhaps Citrix Presentation Server. You can have a hypervisor on the PC with multiple operating systems, or you may have a hypervisor that sits on a removable USB flash drive, kind of like Windows on a stick. So again, the easiest thing that you can possibly do today with very, very little financial impact is to have separate user accounts. Whether you're using Mac, PC, or Linux, you have your employee create separate user accounts. One user account for work, one user account for personal use. You can use fast user switching to switch in between the accounts. You can see in my diagram that the users are pretty much completely separated. Each one has their own applications, each one has their own preferences, each one has their own browsing history, and so on. Now, it is still subject to worms and viruses, because it is two users on the same system. If one user is infected, de facto, the entire operating system is infected. The other downside is you can share information via the common file system by moving files onto one of the common disks that both users use. You can also use a Type 2 hypervisor. This might be either a Microsoft hypervisor or something like Parallels or VMware running on a Macintosh. This is what we call a hosted hypervisor. You're running really two complete versions of the operating system, one down below and one up above, and you can say that one is used for business, one is used for work. The downside here is if the host operating system, which is your base level operating system, gets infected, it is possible that it can go upwards through the hypervisor and infect the other operating system that is being hosted. However, it is hard to accidentally share information, and although cross-contamination is still possible. In summary, you can immediately consult with your legal department, review your current information ownership and protection policies, and make appropriate changes. Put consumerization policies in place if they already aren't. Add separate user accounts. So again, the minimum you can do is to separate the users, personal and corporate, into different user accounts on the host operating system. Longer term, you want to come up with legal policies and procedures and enforce them. You want to have technical policies, procedures, and tools. You need technical tools, such as application isolation and virtualization. And that's my talk today. We also have an in-person talk at the RSA conference, and if you are at the RSA conference, we hope you will attend that. You can also look that longer presentation up on the RSA website as well. My contact information is below, and both Michelangelo and I thank you for your interest in this topic.